So what I want to say to young people, first of all, is don't think you have to pick the exact right degree program in order to end up somewhere where you're doing meaningful content work. There are lots of paths that you can take. What they have in common is that they build your writing skills and hopefully other skills in other channels, right? So not just the ability to write, however that's delivered, but also to think about film, to think about audio, to think about, right? So your ability to create content is obviously important, but it's not enough.
You're listening to All Things Content from Avenue CX, delivering you cutting-edge insights into the past, present, and future of all topics related to content. Here's your host, Kevin Nichols.
Hello, everybody, and welcome. I'm Kevin P. Nichols, and you're listening to All Things Content podcast, where we talk about all things content. I am so excited to be joined today with Dr. Kim Sydow Campbell. She is a professor at the University of North Texas in the Department of Technical Communication. To give you a little bit of information about her, in 1990, Dr. Campbell received her PhD in rhetoric composition and linguistics from Louisiana State University. She is the author of several books, more than 40 papers and book chapters. She's won numerous awards, most recently J.R. Gold Award for Excellence in Teaching that was awarded to her by the Society of Technical Communications. Her course portfolio most recently includes such titles as Digital Content Strategies for Communication Professionals to Digital Literacies for Professional Communicators. I've known her for a while now, and I have to say she's just delightful to talk to because she brings so much to the table when it comes to academic and intellectual knowledge, as well as experiential. She's got a pulse in terms of what younger people out there are bringing to the table as well as a lot of just insightful information of what business is and what business needs are. So it's a really interesting perspective on the intersection between those two. So I'm really excited to have her here with me today. We're going to dive into a lot of interesting topics, so stay tuned for that. First of all, Dr. Campbell, is there anything else you'd like to say that I missed about yourself?
No, thank you for having me, Kevin. I hope I can live up to the hype. All I can say for your audience is that I hope I'll be at least a little more interesting than my bio might suggest.
You definitely will be. I'm quite confident of that. I think the first area that I wanted to get into with you, because I'm actually really curious about it as well, is content as a subject in terms of business is relatively new. You know, I mean, business has been doing it for eons,
forever.
Like publishing, Bill Gates predicted in the 90s, he wrote an essay called Content is King, and predicted this would be the new kind of currency in in commerce, basically, and it would be huge. But this, in terms of thinking of it as a concept for, I guess, academic enterprise and businesses, is relatively new. How did you get started in this in terms of a career in academia? And what brought you to that?
Sure. So what I would say is that I have a lifelong love of language, especially writing. And that really is the foundation that led to everything. I got an undergraduate degree in English linguistics, went on the job market because I decided at the last minute I didn't want to go to law school, and mostly because I didn't want to work with lawyers.
offense to lawyers, I'm
sure. Yeah, that's right. I'm sure you guys are lovely people. I'm sure you are. Anyway, I decided I didn't want to do law, and the job market was really bad in the early 80s. And so I decided that I'd go back to school. I had a professor who encouraged me to think about a PhD. He believed that I could succeed. And so, mentorship is super important, right? In your entire life, that's, mm-hmm. It makes a big difference. And so he encouraged me, I enrolled, I started studying, believe it or not, in technical writing, or what we call tech comm usually. there's really a long tradition, a much longer tradition than from the marketing side of the house, of treating content carefully. And that's because in technical and scientific industries, content has been a part of a product that's been delivered for a very long time, going back to World War II, at least. Probably some people would argue earlier than that. But so there, you know, I'm studying about tech writing. At the same time I'm getting my PhD and taking courses and learning how to do research, I also worked as a tech editor. And I realized that there was a way to make a living being an expert on writing that didn't involve journalism. That also was something that didn't appeal to me. But the technical part of tech writing really did appeal to me. So got my PhD. I've been doing research for 35 or more years now. I've been a professor at four different kinds of universities, four different kinds of colleges even, and academic departments. TechCom doesn't really have a home. I came to the University of North Texas specifically because it's one of the few standalone programs in TechCom anywhere in the world. So that's how I got here.
Wow, really?
Yes.
Interesting. And can you, just for our audience that may not know, can you explain or define a little bit what technical communications mean and what that is? You said it dates back historically, perhaps to World War II. What is it? Can you give us just a brief synopsis of that?
So the way that I would think about it, the way I'd tell your audience to think about it, the thing that everyone's familiar with is instruction manuals that come with products. So that is very definitely the kind of content that tech writers work on. They do more than that, especially in today's world, or for the last 25 years, when we've been delivering information to customers or users on the web, and then in multiple other channels. So much of tech writing is about taking some technical product or information and using enough plain language, good sense, knowledge of the user to make that information something of value for the customer or the potential customer. Does that help?
It does. Can we dive just a little bit more into it? Like, what would be some examples, I guess, in today's world that you would think would resonate? Because I know a lot of people might think, well, it's just a technical manual, but it's so much more than that, right?
It absolutely is. So when I think about the types of genres that our students, for example, create when they go into the workplace, many of them create short instructional videos that go with products. Mm-hmm. They create animated GIFs. Sometimes they produce white papers. Sometimes all of the content is actually developed by subject matter experts and they simply serve as the editor for that content. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they're the person who is in charge of the content on the website. So they're the web designer. There's lots of different words you could use to describe what that function is. But because so much content was moved onto the web early, 20 years ago, technical content I'm talking about, many of the people in our field became content managers. They also do things like write highly technical material for software developers. That is one of the most lucrative areas currently is API writing, UX writing. So it might be the people who are developing the content that goes in the interface on the buttons and in the navigation. So there is overlap between tech writing, between TechCom and MarCom. There always has been. I think there's more now than there was in the past.
Right. So between marketing and communications and technical writing and I think it's just, I'm glad that you defined that. And I think because one of the reasons why I wanted you to define that, and you know this and I know this, but a lot of times in our industry, in digital, interactive, in marketing, in web, in these industries, technical communications and tech comm and tech writing and tech docs, all of these things that kind of fall under the umbrella that you're talking about, don't always get the attention they deserve. And they don't always get the level of respect that they deserve in businesses.
I wanted you to give a
good definition for that, to sort of give, you know, and one thing that has happened for folks, and I keep saying this, is that COVID-19 put supply chain management in the cloud, and it put all this other stuff in the cloud. It made contactless, it made stay at home, all these things necessitate all different types of content, particularly support content, help content, technical content, get elevated in businesses. So technical documentation and technical communication became elevated. And the other thing that it did, and I'm going to shut up and let you talk after this, but it elevated not just marketing, but even more so customer service and the later stages of the customer journey. And with that, technical documentation. And it's important. So businesses are really beginning to, I think, place much more of an emphasis on this. So you've probably seen this as well, but
I think that's absolutely true. And I think that one of the reasons for the isolation of Marcom and Techcom in the past was Techcom typically exists under engineering or under development, or and so they don't necessarily see the people that are in Marcom. So pre-sales, post-sales, two different worlds. Well, of course, we all know now they can't be two separate worlds. Not if the company is going to survive. There really has to be some integration. And so very often that first integration happens between the tech comm folks and the customer support folks, because much of what customer support does is provided to them, believe it or not, by tech comm. So, and that's been true for ever and ever. And so the fact that they've collaborated with each other now more and more over the last 10 years or whatever to create knowledge management, knowledge bases that customers can self-serve and get answers to their questions instead of calling or whatever it is that they had to do before in order to get answers. So the content in those chat bots that are being used, that's tech content. That's tech writing stuff.
It is. And you've seen this. There's an intersectionality between. So there's a huge emphasis placed on brands that are delivering meaningful experiences to customers. Like that's huge right now. Brands that are building trust with the customer. That's huge right now. And that's all also how they're enabling customers to do things that they need to do, right? And that's all being facilitated by like the kinds of things you're talking about, technical documentation,
and it's
enabling that.
What I was going to say is that we've long known, or at least many of us have known for a very long time, that there's a huge disconnect for customers between what they see before the sale and what they see after. And that's not in the company's best interest. It's much better for the company to provide something consistent and something that makes them, as you're saying, trust that the company is taking care of them both when they're trying to entice them to buy, and also then after they buy, and when they're thinking about buying something else, and when they're spreading the word about how good this company is to work for. So for all of those reasons, there's much that can be done in the most effective companies are already breaking down silos where content's concerned.
Absolutely. And I just wanted to give a shout out, to technical documentation and tech marketing there, because I think it's gotten such an elevation in the last couple of years. And it's also intersected with customer experience, and it's customer experience folks are recognizing its importance, as they've themselves have been, the budgets have shifted from marketing to customer experience. So I'm going to shift a little bit, because one question I wanted to ask you as well is, What advice would you give? Because I know you see a lot of younger people, and you engage probably a lot with younger people. What advice would you give somebody that's younger about getting into two things? One, if somebody wants to become a professor in what it is that you do, or your career, but then secondly, in getting into a career of tech docs.
Oh, goodness. I'll answer the easier one and the one I feel more positive about. Okay, so the one I feel more positive about is how to enter the content space these days. Boy, there's not one path. So what I want to say to young people, first of all, is don't think you have to pick the exact right degree program in order to end up somewhere where you're doing meaningful content work. There are lots of paths that you can take. What they have in common is that they build your writing skills and hopefully other skills in other channels, right? So not just the ability to write, however that's delivered, but also to think about film, to think about audio, to think about, right? So your ability to create content is obviously important, but it's not enough. If you want the best paying jobs, you have to be able to do more than create content. You have to be able to collaborate across areas within the company. And the more technical you can be, the higher your paycheck. This is just the reality. It's been this way forever. If you can deal with, and if you can, I know much more about B2B than I do B2C. So almost most tech comm folks end up in B2B environments because they're products that are super expensive. You know, you think about aerospace, individuals other than Jeff Bezos are not buying aerospace products, right? This is a B2B world we're talking about that tends to be higher paying than consumer. And the thing that's important beyond knowing how to create multiple types of content, collaboration, teamwork is super important. And the ability to show that you can learn technical tools. And I mean, really, I mean that broadly. So if you can use Google Analytics, awesome. If you can use a component content management system, awesome. I think these days you need to be able to do more than use WordPress. It's something. It's better than nothing. But the more you can demonstrate that you've learned tools that are used in the content space, the better off you're going to be, because you need a portfolio. Right. And in that portfolio, what you're going to do is you're going to show, I can write, I can work on a team, I can manage projects, right? I can deliver on time, on budget. I can learn new technology. I emphasize with my students all the time, you cannot think of tech as something that you learn and it's over. Instead, I remember when I started teaching, I had physical handouts and PowerPoint hadn't even been invented yet. So I've learned many technologies over the years, and it's not going to stop. I think it's super important that they be able to demonstrate they can learn tools.
That's such great. I mean, I love all of this advice. I think it's really good because you didn't go into any specific, oh, learn this tool or this. You went into the what's necessary from a growing your capacity, standpoint, and what's going to stand you up for long-term success. Yep. What you didn't do is touch on the more difficult piece of the question, which is how would somebody get into your specific career?
Honestly, I don't know what I would tell someone today. So, let me tell you why. The reason hesitate is because at the PhD level, the thing that matters most is mentorship, because it's basically an apprentice model, right? You're going to work with one person for 4 years, probably. And that person is, you'll take a few courses from other people, but that one person is really going to be the person that helps you figure out how to be a professor. And not all professors do research, but where you get a PhD, it's guaranteed that your mentor is going to be doing research because there are no PhD programs right. in all liberal arts schools. So, or almost none. And so it's, I think that here's what I would say. Go to something called Google Scholar. Do you know what I'm talking about? Okay, Google Scholar is a marvelous tool for finding lots of things, but you can find researchers. So if you do a search in there for terms that interest you, like put in content strategy, see what names keep popping up. You can click on the names, and it will tell you where that person is. It will give you a list of their publications, which will give you an idea of what their area of expertise is and how old it is. Right? So the younger the person is, obviously, the less they will have made their knowledge available to the rest of us. But I really think that's the best way to go about this, because there's not one, there's not even one kind of academic program to prepare you. There are lots. You could do this in journalism. You could do it in a PR kind of program. You could do it in marketing. You could do it in management information systems. You could do it in information science. You could do it in an English department. You might be able to do it in a communication studies department. So I know that that seems overwhelming. For any listeners who are truly interested, we'll end the episode by giving my contact info. I'm glad to help people think about where to start. It's a pretty complicated business.
Yeah, I just wanted to throw it out there because I think there are people that probably do want to go down that academic track, right? Academia is so competitive. Like, we think business is competitive. I mean, you all are in a league of your own. Like, you can't touch that with a 10-foot pole.
Yes. And it's, of course, it's such a niche and so small and insular that, you know, there are all kinds of weird things that outsiders would never be able to predict. And that's why it's really helpful to have somebody who knows the industry help you figure out what to do. So you could go to a professor that you've had and ask for advice too. That would be another great thing to do.
So I'm going to shift gears a little bit. I want to talk a little bit about your actual courses because I know a little bit about this. full disclosure. You seem very intent, on standing your students up for real world success. And I love this. I know that you actually bring into your curriculum real-world use cases, and you actually bring in the opportunity for students to work on actual project work from actual clients, from actual businesses. I want you to talk a little bit about that, but what are the challenges there, and how have you done this?
Well, there are lots of challenges. I'm prepared to talk about a few, but basically what's required is, especially in the content space, because things change so fast, I don't believe anyone can succeed by finding, I don't even know if there is one, a so-called textbook. There's not going to be some academic textbook out there that's going to provide students with the information they need. So I just don't ever even look. I always look for industry publications, which is how Kevin and I met, right? I have used his enterprise content strategy book with my grad students for a while now. It's great because it's project focused and it's slim. And it is. It's slim, which is good. I can fill in where needed with the students, but the last thing they need is to be overwhelmed with information. There's way too much to know. They're only going to get a taste. And at the end of the course, they will have had a content experience that will have showed them some of the tools you use, some of the concerns you have to have, some of the things you have to know. And then they're going to leave the course and they're obviously going to have to continue learning because it's not possible to do all of that. Our courses are all 8 weeks long. Not all. Mm-hmm. All of our grad courses are 8 weeks long. So it's a full semester, 16 hours worth of work in half the time. So it's very intense. Very intense. So you asked me about challenges, Kevin. Where students are concerned, the major challenge is getting them out of thinking like a student. So students want to only perform perfectly, or most of them do, right? They want to be able to, what's the answer? And I'm going to give you the correct answer. As anyone in the professional world knows, professionals get paid to make decisions in ambiguous circumstances. That describes the real world. There is no one right answer. Hardly ever, right? Hardly ever. There are multiple, and there are multiple ways to get to that answer, right? So, So it's the hardest thing really is psychological. In other words, it's encouraging my students to recognize they're going to make mistakes and that's okay. I'm not going to hold them. Yes, there are things that I'm going to evaluate for quality, but it's not, they still are allowed to make mistakes. And, you know, they've been in school for a very long time. They don't necessarily trust me until they've had another course with me, maybe, and then they trust me a little bit more. But it's very scary for them, as it is for any junior person who starts a job, right? You're scared to death you're going to do the wrong thing. That's the major challenge with students. The major challenge with businesses as clients, honestly, there aren't that many. Here's the biggest one. If they don't know me and they've never done a student project with anyone ever before, they're scared to death to talk to me because they think that, for example, I've never heard of an NDA and how could they possibly talk about their content with a bunch of students who could be on social media talking about, you know what I mean? So we complete an NDA with every client we work with. And I've never had a problem with students displaying anything they should not or talking about things they should not, but industry doesn't know that because most people have never worked with students in this kind of a project. And so I think they don't even pay attention. They don't want to engage, even if they're interested. And they think it's going to be a lot of work. What I would say is we do the work. I don't require very much from any of them, more than 5 hours worth of their time, I would say. For an entire project. So the good news is it's not as hard as they think, but that is a challenge, overcoming their reluctance.
And to be clear, you work with actual companies or businesses to work on a project that you bring into your course curriculum that the students focus on to do a measurable or some type of an outcome-based project that the students can actually work through a particular problem in order to solve a business problem.
So I'll give you an example. I'm not going to name, because I signed NDAs, I'm not going to tell you who the companies are. But for example, my most recent content strategy folks worked with a medium-sized professional services organization who is housed here in Texas. The way I found them is the way I find most of our clients. Somebody who was one of my students works there now. So alumni are my greatest source of projects. What they needed was going through a website design. So like many companies, they were unprepared to deliver everything virtually. They do a lot of training. They used to do a lot of on-site training or conference training or, you know, where people had to travel. And obviously that didn't happen over the last 2 years. And so they had to take all their stuff and throw it up on the web without a whole lot of planning in advance. And so my former student knew that they needed help, knew that their website was a mess, and they know it. They're going through a big redesign, but what they didn't budget for was the content part. And so, you know, they're getting a new tool and they've gotten, you know, this is a very common story, right? They've spent some money, but they didn't think about what a mess the content actually is. and what it would be required to fix it. So what my students did over 5 weeks was a detailed content inventory and audit of their website, one portion of their site, not everything. They provided a short report, but really the main deliverable is a massive spreadsheet with the audit information for each content asset. So they identified simple things like broken links. They identified more complex things that the company hadn't thought about, like accessibility, ADA concerns. I could go on and on. But so what the client got absolutely valuable.
Right.
This is something they're definitely going to use. And they didn't have to use their own resources to get that work done. I'm sure it's not perfect, but it probably wouldn't have been perfect even if it had been done in-house. So it's a way for
to
start. Yeah, it's a way for them to start thinking about what they need to do in terms of making their content searchable, providing an experience for users that is easy. It's easy to find what they want. They understand what they want. There's consistency in the content, all those things.
And what a great way to work through with your students, how to actually do the actual work, engage with a client. And I mean, I never got that type of an opportunity. Like, I went to a liberal arts school and I got an incredible education. I learned how to think critically, how to write, like all those things. You know, we studied the classics, all that kind of stuff. But it was completely removed from the real world. I mean, use the term insular, and it was completely insular. Speaking of, how do you get the students? So you talked a little bit about, you know, they want to get that A, or they want to like get that really good grade, and there's in their mindset, they don't want to do anything that is wrong in their mindset. But what about the practicality of the business world? Because especially the graduate students, because I also went to graduate school, and there was, it was very academic and it was very removed from reality. I mean, we, you know, I did a lot of philosophy and that kind of stuff, which is anything but. So what about time and efficiency and practicality and the things that businesses tend to embrace? Like, how do you get them to like,
this is
think that
this,
way?
This is probably, well, there are two huge challenges, I would say, in trying to bridge academe and industry with my students. But one of them is definitely, so it depends on the student somewhat, how business savvy they are. We have a lot of career changers. Right. And so they've already, you know, and they could come from, we have people from many, many, many different careers. High school teachers, college teachers. We have IT technicians. We have PR professionals. We have, you know, we get a lot of different kinds of people in our graduate program. So we have both an MA, but we also have a certificate. So the certificate tends to draw people who are already, they have experience, but not necessarily the experience that they think they need in order to get the kind of job they want. So those more experienced people are easier to manage because they already know their employers care about using resources. Like everything is not, you're not going to get an infinite amount of time to create the highest quality content that you could. That's just not reality. And so one of the things that I do with students, so one of the courses I teach is our tech editing course. And in that course, my grad students do two projects for two different clients. And in one of them, in the bigger project, I have them create a proposal that includes an estimate of time charged for different kinds of levels of editing, different types of material that's going to be edited. And I tell them up front, you have, I think it's like 25 hours over 3 weeks. You figure out what you can do. Well, of course, most of the time they overestimate what they can do, but that's part of the learning experience, right? I don't hold them accountable for actually having to go through. I hold them accountable for, can you reflect on what happened? I mean, I also look at what they edited, obviously, but I'm interested in their reflection on what did you learn? How does this inform what you're going to do when you get to the workplace? And scope is a huge deal because, I mean, it's a huge deal for everyone, right? Nobody who really creates content wants to give up before it's perfect. Right?
It's so true. It's so true. And people overestimate in our profession scope. Even seasoned people will overestimate.
Yes.
Like,
yes.
I don't do it. I mean, because I think it's a bunch. Yeah. You want to be honest and you want to be transparent. Yes. It doesn't be like nobody gets ahead by overestimating scope, but I see it all the time.
Yep. Me too.
I mean, sometimes unintentionally, sometimes naively, especially with less seasoned, more overzealous or more but
it's
a lot of times intentionally too.
It's such an important lesson to at least have the idea that scope matters in your head as a content professional. It matters. Like, you can't just spend an endless amount of time or resources. I mean, the time is resources.
And time equals money, right?
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
I mean, that's the bottom line.
It is. One of the other things that's funny about you asking this question now is that I recently, just this week, submitted a paper, an academic paper for publication with one of my other favorite content strategists. That would be Val Swisher over at CEO of Content Rules. Well, Val and I collaborated together on a paper that presents a model for, it's a maturity model. So what it's designed to do is help an organization analyze where they're at in terms of all their content operations, not just creation, right? But also management, headcount, you know, blah, blah, scheduling, the whole, right? So you go through the entire analysis, just like any management consultant, you identify gaps in what you're doing, what you'd like to be able to do, and then you come up with a strategy for getting where you want to go. But you get that strategy by prioritizing, right? So you can't just randomly choose stuff like, oh, let's buy a new tool, or let's update the style guide, or like, it just, that, because that's not the way business operates. So I love this paper we did. It will become required reading for my students because it helps them think through, why does the business care how long it takes to create the content? Why do they care if they can reuse that content?
It's the number one thing that I like to get businesses always think about content performance in terms of how it's performing externally. Right. And I'm like, what are your internal performance metrics in measuring the performance of content? Tell me how long it takes to produce a content by its content type. Tell me the time for a review cycle, content create, because if they can't do that, then they can't quantify content as an asset. Quantify it as an asset, folks out there, you've got to cross-reference the time it takes and the cost of it with how it's performing externally. And that's the whole point.
One of the advantages of having come from TechCom is that structured content, multi-channel delivery has been around for us for longer than it has been for Marcom. I've been teaching students to do structured authoring, also called topic-based writing, also called modular components, whatever. I've been doing that for many, many, many years. Students hate it until they understand. I mean, they do. They hate it. They don't want to write a module. They want to write the novel, you know? And what I tell them is you can write the novel on your own time, unless, you know what I mean? Like, your employer is not, you know, you can write your novel. But your employer is more interested. And once they see that it's actually quite a challenge to write a good, it's not easy, right? And so then they start figuring out, oh, this is kind of, oh, how do I tweak this? And how do I, so right. It's very language focused, plain language as much as you can, follow the style guide. Don't think about format at all, because the format is totally separate and is going to be determined by whatever channel the content goes into. It's pretty eye-opening for students, but it's one of the reasons our students get great jobs too, because they already have, you know, this much experience working in a content management system.
And it's not easy at all. And it takes a ton of creativity too. I mean, I think that's what people don't think. Like, it's as much difficult as it is to write like a byline or to write like ad copy or to write whatever,
absolutely.
You know, to think it through. And then to do it from a user-centric perspective, even more so, because you really have to think through what that user needs and how to connect to them, and to distill these oftentimes highly technical concepts that are business-focused and put them into a language that the user is going to understand. And
absolutely,
it's a lot of creativity. And
there
it takes a lot of knowledge of the product or like the level of
it
product.
It does, absolutely. And so, you know what, really, they're very resistant in the beginning, but by the time they get farther into it and they realize that they're in fact creating a piece of data that is incredibly well structured and well thought out and is going to be able to be plugged into wherever it needs to be. I think that they eventually find it. I think it is creative. It's just creative in a different way.
Yeah. And one thing that I try to get custom, like one thing that I'm trying to do and like my stuff is to get the connection between that type of content and the customer experience elevated. It drives such an impact in the customer experience, and that you
absolutely.
Can quantify the customer experience with that type of content.
Yep.
And because so, it elevates, like, so I'm trying to get tech docs to get better relationships with customer experience so they can quantify their impact on it and tell that story. I want to, and speaking of that, like, what are some of the themes that you see as important in 2022 for businesses and content to adopt? And how are you, you know, thinking of possibly addressing them in your courses? But let's start with the themes that you think are important in 2022. I think this is going to be my last question for you.
I would actually say I'm the lag indicator. So like, I think the content professionals in industry are the ones that are innovating, and I'm just trying to keep up with them. What I hear, so I hear a lot about virtual work. This is not really new, but it's certainly vastly expanded. And so, you know, there are a lot of practices that content professionals use or that they're used to engaging in that are just different if they're done virtually. So I don't see that that's going away. And I think it's going to be, as we all read the news, right? There's a little tug going on between, does industry need to control its employees? And, you know, how is this all going to shake out? I definitely think that the students who, our students do a great job because they're online. So they know how to use, we teach them to use tools like Teams and Slack and project management stuff like Asana or Trello, or, you know, like we made sure they know how to manage projects virtually and interact with each other. I think that it's really important for an employer to know that you can handle that if you're going to work online. I also think, you know, structure's not going away. Structured content is more important than it's ever been in the sense of across the organization, across silos. So I think that, I think that there are a lot of people who don't necessarily understand yet what that means. I think that that's why this collaboration you're talking about with tech pubs, with the tech docs people and other folks who are responsible for customer experience and marketing or wherever, they really need to talk to each other, because I think tech pubs would be really helpful in helping them think about what you can do and how to do it. The other thing,
and the
is
reason
AI.
That you're saying this is because they do get structured content.
Yes,
by the way,
we've
folks.
Been doing so it for, yes. for 20 years. For 20 years, we've yes. been doing it. Right, exactly. Yes. And part of that is because no one wants to spend money, or at least they didn't used to, on tech docs. They spend it on the mm-hmm. research and development in engineering, mm-hmm. but engineering doesn't want to spend money on tech docs. So we had to figure out how to do things efficiently and consistently, also because tech docs have to be most large-ish companies, they're probably translating their stuff into 30 languages. So if you can imagine the translation cost of every one of those documents being different, as opposed to all of them made up of the same chunks.
Right.
Like, obviously, you're going to save huge money. So, yeah. The other thing I would say is definitely not going away. It's coming, and it's here, honestly, is AI.
Yep.
My students yep. are, by the time they finish our courses, they realize that computers can write good content. Not right. not great, not all the time. It depends. But they can, and that's can right. be very scary. Sounds like yep. maybe you're going out of a job. I don't think that that's true. It no. depends on what you're doing. You know, if all you can do yep. is fix grammar, yeah, you're out. I'm sorry, but like, there's not going to be much work for you. Computers can do that faster and better than a human.
But they're not creative, and they can't do empathy, and they can't create yeah. like yeah they yeah. they can't
somebody
do
has things. To train the machine, and that's where yes. we come in, is we're the knowledge
Absolutely.
experts. We're the ones who know the language, we know the user, we know
and those machine learning, whether you're talking about a CDP, a cross data platform, or any of it, require mm-hmm. I mean, they're not silver bullet solutions. They require a ton of human infrastructure to support.
Absolutely.
So marketing scientists, data scientists, content strategists,
yes.
structured data solutions, structured
content
solutions.
As with every tool, vendors like to say they solve every issue, but in reality, they don't solve issues until there are humans that know how to implement them. And then maybe, right?
But they actually require more people in your organization to stand them up correctly and then to maintain them. Yeah. Then they require less people. And that's my whole point, that I think from a career standpoint.
Yes. I think we're not at a place where, I mean, AI, it's whatever, it's come a long, long way. And students are shocked to see what a computer can write. But it has to be all the back end stuff, right? The stuff they're learning to do in my digital literacies class with metadata, and with structuring content into topic types, and making sure that all the right stuff is inside that topic, that's what makes the AI work.
Absolutely, absolutely. Dr. Campbell, this has been amazing. I knew it was gonna be a great, great conversation. In terms of people reaching out to you or following you or getting in touch with you, how are people to best do that? And by the way, we are going to put Dr. Campbell's information in all of the places that this is being published. So you will have that there. But
excellent.
Could you just, for the people listening.
I'm happy to, if you want to go old school and use email, it's simple. It's kim.campbell@unt.edu. I'm on Twitter as Dr. Kim. I'm probably most active on LinkedIn. Please connect with me there. I rarely turn anybody away. I love to hear what's going on in industry. Obviously, that's how I am able to deliver something of value to my students. So please reach out. And if you want to talk about a client project, I'm listening.
I love it. I love it. Thank you again for being with us today. This has been absolutely just an incredible conversation. I'm Kevin Nichols. You've been listening to All Things Content Podcast, and I want to thank everybody for joining us. Stay well, be well, and I will see you next time.
That was All Things Content with Kevin Nichols. Thanks for listening. Remember to leave a like and a comment if you're watching on YouTube, a 5-star review if you're listening on Apple Podcasts, or a follow if you're listening on Spotify. You can connect with Kevin on LinkedIn or follow him on Twitter at KP Nichols. You can also connect with his company by following Avenue CX on LinkedIn, Twitter, or Facebook at Avenue CX. All Things Content with Kevin Nichols is a production of Kevin P. Nichols and Avenue CX. Thanks again for listening.